Oh, glory to God, glory to God. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. And he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world. Wherefore, you that do truly and earnestly repent of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God, oh, glory to God. Let us bless his holy name today. Somebody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Somebody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Raise your hands towards heaven and say, praise the Lord.
Provoking most justly your wrath and indignation against us, we do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen and amen.
Holy, 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 all the same. Also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the light. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you will know my Father as well. For now, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. May the Lord add a blessing to the hearers and readers of his holy word. Amen.
I need your grace more than I thought I ever would. You forgave more than I thought you ever could.
Another day, another hour, another minute, and another second, Lord, that you've given to each and every one of us. And we're grateful. Grateful. Grateful with grateful hearts, Lord Jesus. For you watched over each and every one of us through this week, Lord Jesus. Protected us from all hurt, harm, and danger, Lord Jesus. You put your angels of protection around us, Lord, and we say thank you, Lord. We thank you right now, Lord Jesus, for all that you've done, all that you continue to do in our lives and shall do. We thank you, Lord. Shower down your blessings upon us, Lord Jesus. Cleanse us, Lord Jesus, from the inside out. Purify each and every one of our hearts, Lord Jesus, that you might fill it up with your Holy Spirit. Let your Holy Spirit dwell in us today, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you,
God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. So much we got to be thankful for, Lord Jesus. But you know all about it. But we just come today just to say thank you, Lord. Thank you for keeping us. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for being who you are in our lives today, Lord Jesus. Because we couldn't do nothing without you. And we say thank you. Thank you from the bottom of our hearts, from the depths of our soul, that we cry out. And when we cry out, you answer each crying call, Heavenly Father. You fulfill our needs, Lord Jesus. You supply everything that we need. And we're grateful. If we had 10,000 tongues, we couldn't thank you enough. Blot out our transgressions, Lord Jesus. Blot them out right now, Lord Jesus, one by one. Cleanse us, Lord Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your healing power. Thank you for the food that you provided. Thank you for the shelter. Thank you for this worship hour. Thank you for the building, Lord Jesus, that we've come to worship you in. Thank you for the building that shall be built in your name's sake. Bless each brick that is planted, each brick that is built, that you will receive the glory and honor and all praises that's due to you. Bless the shepherd of this flock, Lord Jesus. Bless him right now, Lord Jesus. Touch him from the head to his feet, Lord Jesus. Fill him up where he needs to be filled, Lord Jesus. Take out what is not pleasing in your sight, Lord Jesus, that he can continue to preach your blessed words and teach to those that you've called him to teach to and minister to souls that need to be saved. Allow the transformation to take place today, Lord Jesus, in the airways and in person, Lord Jesus, that we might not be the same as we leave today, Lord Jesus. And we say thank you. Bless our First Lady and thank you for her travel mercies and bringing her home safely. For she was in the vineyard, sharing a word to those you called her to share a word to. And we thank you for her dedication. We thank you for her love and support that she stands by our pastor, her husband, and sharing the love to each and every one of us, Lord Jesus. We thank you for the mighty works that you called her to do and her obedience to do it, Lord Jesus. Bless the leaders of this church, Heavenly Father. Bless the ushers that stand at the door. Bless the greeters as they greet those that come in and usher them into the worship service. Bless this music ministry collectively and individually. Continue to allow them to share their gifts and talents. The music of the melodies, sweet melodies, Lord. Sweet melodies to our ears. Bless the media tech, Heavenly Father. Bless the clergy. Bless us all, Heavenly Father, as a congregation. And we will forever give your name the glory, the honor, and the praise. And we say thank you, Lord. Amen.
have to do is put your trust in me. Because I am God, how about it?
Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Our text is John 14, verse 2. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I want to talk from this thought. If it were not so. Did y'all hear that?
Yes.
If it were not so. Have you ever received word that one of your loved ones had been diagnosed with serious illness, perhaps heart disease, chronic lower respiratory issues, Alzheimer's, aggressive cancer, COVID-19, and on a ventilator, could be sickle cell anemia, or perhaps nowadays a drive-by shooting. Or you heard that the grocery store that you shop in every week was invaded by a gunman. Sometimes it's a bad car accident, and it's your son or your daughter who's seriously injured. And you're told that they only have hours to live. I have had that situation in my life. And let me tell you, your heart has a different ache. When the phone rings, it has a different beat. It's a troubled situation. Life for Jesus' disciples was similar to that. Their life was going to fall in. Have you ever had things just cave in on you? And you're trying to figure how to get out? Their son was going down, the S-U-N, was going to set at midday, and the world was going to collapse in chaos all around them. But why were they so troubled? Just a few hours before Jesus went to the cross, Jesus gave a difficult command to his disciples. Do not let your heart be troubled. These words of present tense imperative that can be translated, stop being troubled. People will say that to you, don't worry about it. Don't be troubled. Take it easy. Stop being troubled. This implies that the disciples are already anxious and already troubled. This command suggests that heart trouble is something that can be conquered. No matter how rough it seems, no matter how low you may think you have sunk, no matter how serious the problem, your heart trouble can be conquered. Are you still here?
Yes.
If you're like me, you're expecting Jesus to give some simple solution to overcome your heart trouble. Jesus does give the cure for the heart trouble in the second part of this verse. He simply says, believe in God and believe also in me. No more, no less. Jesus is saying, accept my word because they are true and faithful. You can have confidence in what I say. You can trust me, he says. Just have faith in me. If I had told you, are you still here? First of all, this text shows us the honesty of Jesus. If it were not so, then Jesus asked, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? No one could ever claim that he or she has been tricked into Christianity by suspicious promises or under false pretenses. Jesus is not like a slick salesperson whose only goal is to get you to sign on the dotted line. Jesus told people bluntly and plainly of the farewell to comfort his Christians as they must go. He told them about the persecution, the hatred, the penalty they would have to bear. He told them, and he's telling us, Oh, the burden of the cross they must carry. But he told them also of the glory of the ending of the Christian way. Jesus clearly and frankly and honestly told people what they might expect of glory and of the pain if they followed him. He was not a leader who tried to bribe people with promises of an easy way. He tried to challenge them into greatness, if it was not so. He wouldn't have told you. Secondly, listen to this. He tells us of the function of Jesus. He said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. Yeah. One of the greatest thoughts of the New Testament is that Jesus goes on in front of us so that we can follow. Amen. Oh, glory to God. Yeah. Are y'all still here? He opens up the way which we may take and follow into his death. One of the great words used to describe Jesus is the word prodromos. The NIV version translates the word as a forerunner. There are two uses of the word which light up the picture within. The Roman army, in the Roman army, these are the people of the reconnaissance troops. They went ahead of the main body of the army to blaze the trail. Yeah. And to ensure that it was safe for the rest of the troops to follow. The harbor of Alexandria was very difficult to approach. When the great ships came in, to it, a little pilot boat was sent out to guide them. It went before them and they followed it. And it led them along the channel to safe waters. The pilot boat was called the Prodromos. It went first to make it safe for the others to follow. That is what Jesus did for you, and that's what Jesus did for me. Yeah. He blazed the way to heaven and to God that we might follow in his steps. Yeah. He said, if it was not so, if it was not so, I would not have told you. Thirdly, he says, it tells us of the ultimate triumph of Jesus. Listen to what he says. Jesus says, I am coming again. Isn't that good news? This is a very defiant reference to the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says, if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, you may be there also. You heard that I said to you, I go away and I will come to you. If you love me, you will have rejoiced because I'm going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. Acts 1:11 says, men of Galilee, why do you stand here looking into the sky? The same Jesus who was taken up to you into heaven will come back just like you saw him leave. But the day nor the hour, no one knows. Not even the angels, nor the Son, but only the Father. If it was, not so. Now hear this. Jesus said, where I'm going, there you will be also. There's a great truth put in the simplest way for us Christians, heaven is where Jesus is. Y'all still here? We don't need to speculate on what heaven will be like. It's enough to know that we will be with him forever. When we love anyone with our whole hearts, life begins when we are with that person. It is only in their company that we are really and truly alive. It is so with Christ. In this world, our contact with him is shadowy. We can only see through a glass darkly. The Message version puts it this way. We don't see things clearly. We are squinting in the fog, peering through the mist. But it won't be long before the weather clears and the sun shines bright. We'll see it all then. See it all as clearly as God sees us. Knowing him directly just as he knows us. But for right now, until that completeness, we have three things to do to lead us toward consummation. Trust steadily in God, hope unwaveringly, love extravagantly. And the best of the three is to love. If it was not so. The Bible has some good news for us. I said the Bible has some good news for us. The Bible says that God promised salvation to all who believe in his son. If it was not so. I said if it was not so. He wouldn't have said that. If it was not so, he would not have told us that all things work together for good. For his children. Oh, bless his name. He promised that he would comfort us through our trials. If it was not so, he would not have told us. He promised us new life in Christ Jesus. You know that salvation is the beginning of a brand new existence. If it was not so, he promised every spiritual blessing is available in Christ Jesus. Oh, glory to God. The Bible says in the Old Testament, Israel had the promise of physical blessing. The church today has the promise of spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms. Our inheritance is reserved for us. God promised to finish the work that he started in us. Oh, glory to God. God does nothing in half measures. He started the work in us, and he will surely complete it. If he hadn't told us, he wouldn't have said it. Oh, glory to God. God has promised us peace when we pray. His peace, his protection. He will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. God promised to supply all your needs according to your riches and glory. Oh, glory to God. Jesus promised rest. He promised burdens would be lifted at Calvary. Jesus promised eternal life to those who trust in him. The Bible tells us that he's the good shepherd, that he will take care of his sheep. Jesus promised his disciples. say power. This power that he gave to his apostles that turned the world upside down. People are still reading and talking about it today. But Jesus promised that he will return for us. I said he promised that he would return. And he told us in the 14th chapter, the second verse, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, he would have told you. He said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, he said, I will come again and receive you unto myself, and that he will come again to receive you unto himself. The Bible says in Revelation number 1 verse 7, behold, he comes in the clouds, and every eye shall see him. Oh, glory to God. Every single eye will see him, and they which pierced him in his side, and all the kingdoms of the earth shall see him and wail of him. Even so, amen. I want you to know today, he said that he's coming. He's coming one of these days. I don't know when he's coming. I don't know the day. I don't know the hour. But if he said he's coming, and said if he said he's coming, you better believe he's coming. And he's coming. He's coming to take the church with him. In other words, one of these old days, I don't know how long it's going to be. When he comes, we shall. We shall be changed. It won't take a long time. The word said in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the sound of the trumpet, the dead in Christ shall rise. The rest shall be caught up. Somebody say caught up to meet him.
Done a few things in this world. You're not going because you're saved.
church, you're only going because the blood of Jesus has washed you. The blood of Jesus has saved you.